14 to 7 on 3AW, and Elizabeth's next on the line. Hello, Elizabeth.
Hello, Bruce. Hello, Philip.
Welcome to 3AW's Remember When.
Thank you, Philip. I was just reminiscing with when Bruce was saying the different clothes that we used to wear.
Yes.
And I would have left school in about 1958, and I've just written down some of the things we just had to have. We had to have the greasy wool crossover neck jumpers. You know, they sort of crossed over and they were in a greasy type wool.
That's right, and they were sort of a semi-polo neck, weren't they?
That's right, but they sort of crossed across.
Yes.
And to go with tartan slacks and desert boots.
Yes.
And cat's eye sunglasses. Cat's eyes.
Yeah, right.
And dog collar belts that looked like a dog collar. And
oh, that's right, studded, weren't they?
Yes.
And they were very wide.
Yes, or you could get a small one too, and they, you could wear them around your neck, but they look like a dog collar.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And to have white wool tyres on the cars, you don't see those these days.
That's right.
And I remember caramellos bars, sweets that you used to eat, caramellos.
Yes.
You can still buy them, can't you? Cadbury's caramello?
I don't think so.
Oh, I mean.
And okanuis, everyone used to have an okanui?
Yes, those pants.
No, okanuis like a surfboard.
Oh, I thought they were pants.
Oh, yes, that's right. And the okanui pants, that's right. And, driving gloves that were sort of lace on the top and pigskin on the underneath.
Yes, I had a pair of those.
And camel hair coats.
Oh, that's right.
And T-bar sandals.
Yes.
And that's about all.
Well, I think you've said enough, Elizabeth, for a box of lovely chocolates from the chocolatier.
Oh, that's lovely, Bruce.
If you'd like them.
Thank you very much. I would. That's very, very kind of you.
Well, you hold the line and I'll get right back to you.
Good.
You brought back a lot of lovely memories, Elizabeth.
Oh, good. Thank you very much, Bruce.
Thank you. Just hold on. This is 3AW and it's Remember When, Sunday night at 11 to 7.
Next time you're at the supermarket, check the back of your docket. It could send you to Daydream Island.
Wow.
If your shopping docket is a 3AW shopper docket, send it to us along with your name and address and you'll go into the draw.
3AW's Lawyers, Guns and Money, Margaret Fletcher and Philip Brady and Bruce Mansfield could call out your name.
You'll have 30 minutes to phone in. You could win a weekend for two at the St Kilda Road Travelodge or a family holiday on Daydream Island flying East West Airlines. Shop a docket only on 1278 3AW.
How will you invest your lump sum when you retire? There's the good old bank.
Next, please.
And won't the tax man be happy? Invest in a business. But some of those are... Or talk to your national mutual agent about investing in a retirement income annuity and get a regular guaranteed income for a fixed term or for the rest of your life. It's like having a job without having to work.
Yep.
National Mutual Retirement Income Annuities. Peace of mind. For the most important person in the world, you.
This is Remember When, and it's Sunday night in Melbourne.
3AW in Melbourne.
It's 10 to 7, and our radio historian will be in at about 7:30 tonight, Alex Eyre.
Oh, yes, I'm looking forward to that. He has a fantastic library of material at home.
Indeed.
Paraphernalia, memorabilia, and ephemera.
Yes, all local radio that you'll all remember. Hello to Tony.
Good evening.
Hi, Tony.
How's it going? Do you remember when Jevote Srpskinarod was around?
When what?
Jevote Černička Banda.
No, I can't recall that. Thanks a lot. Hello, John.
Yes, good evening, Bruce and Phil.
Hello, John.
Good, thank you. I'm wondering if you could advise me if you'll guest at 7:30, is it Alex Eyre? He'll be able to advise if there's anything in amongst his collection of a radio program back on 3DB. I think it was from 1953 to about 1956, prior to introduction of television. a children's program. It's more or less aimed at the teenage audience called the Thaker McGangies. Have you either heard of that at all?
I had a very small part in that program, and it was conducted by a woman called Jean Lawson, and it, I think, went to air at 4:30 of an afternoon, 4 or 5 o'clock, because I went in from school and watched them doing it to air live.
Was any of it recorded, Bruce?
No, it wasn't. There is no recording of the Thaker McGangies, unfortunately.
Would you have any introduction music, or maybe John Ferguson might have an idea what the track was played as the introduction?
Well, I think Alex Hare might answer that for you about 7:30 when he comes in.
Oh, fine.
Keep listening, John.
Very good. And the other thing was, do you think you'd be playing some more Daddy and Paddy later on?
Well, I've got a real treat for you next week, and that is I have Paddy, hopefully, as special guest on the line.
Oh, very good.
The original Paddy McLean.
Thank you, Bruce.
We're also hoping next Sunday night to talk to Guy Mitchell, who's coming to Australia to tour, and Vivian O'Shea from his fan club is trying to line up an interview for us for next Sunday night.
Mm-hmm. All the best, fellas.
All right, John. Thanks for the call, and Alex here will be listening and will answer that question for you.
Thank you.
See you, John.
Good night.
Bye-bye. Margaret's next. Yes, welcome to Remember When. Margaret?
Right, good evening. Do you remember air raid practice? In 1941 at Glen Iris State School.
Bruce would be too young for that.
Well, there you go. No, we used to have air raid practice that they used to sound the sirens, and everybody used to file out very nicely out of the classrooms, go into trenches and crouch with their arms above their heads.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. 1941.
I can remember air raid shelters. Most municipal parks around Melbourne had their own underground shelter.
Trenches dug in the schoolyards, and the children used to have to go out and file into them.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
That must have been about the time that Japan invaded Pearl Harbor and then Darwin.
No, this was in 1941.
Right, so that's even before the Pacific War.
Mm-hmm. That, and do you remember being milk monitor?
Oh,
and
yes.
You had to go and get the little warm bottles of milk out of the sunshine and bring them in?
That's right, before the magpies got to the silver lids.
There are a lot of very funny memories.
Aren't they lovely?
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember those migrant hostels near Clifton Hill, where the train goes off from Mary Creek, over the Mary Creek?
Well, I don't remember those ones, but I remember the ones at Holmes Glen.
But they were dreadful. They were galvanised iron, Phil, that were sort of made a U-shape, and that's where people lived. It must be hellishly hot there.
They looked like aircraft hangars, didn't they?
Lots of them, and actually on High Street Road near Ashwood, there are still some of them standing, and it's now a licensed liquor store.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, well, there was one at Campbell and there was one at Bonagilla.
That's
right.
There
were several of them around Melbourne.
Yeah.
Yes, all sorts of interesting things.
Lovely, Margaret. Okay. Thanks for your call, dear.
Right.
Bye-bye.
Good night.
This is 3AW and this is Remember When. Nice to have you company this Sunday night.
You get 60 cups of delicious instant coffee from every big economical bottle of Turban coffee essence.
It's most disturbing when there ain't no Turban.
Now, Phil, I have for you the jingle that you brought in on the first or second night of Remember When, the Flying Red Horse. What's the history to it?
Oh, well, thanks to John Ferguson, we're playing this. You stop at the sign of the Flying Red Horse. It's quite a long jingle. It lasts about the length of a song, I remember. And I think originally it was an American jingle package.
I love to go riding with Daddy, and he always takes me, of course. He stops for his gas and his oil at the sign of the Flying Red Horse.
Oh, the service is friendly, so friendly, you'll see, and everything's clean and so neat. They polish your windshield, check water and oil. It's service you simply can't beat.
It's fun to go riding with Daddy,
and I love to take you, of course.
And it's fun to stop in for the service we get at the sign of the Flying Red Horse.
loves to go riding with Daddy. And he always takes her, of course. He stops for his gas and his oil at the sign of the Flying Red Horse. Oh, the service is friendly, so friendly you'll see. And everything's clean and so neat. They polish your windshield, check water and oil. It's service you simply can't beat.
It's fun to go riding with Daddy.
And I love to take you, of course. And it's fun to stop in for the service we get at the sign of the Flying Red Horse. You, of course, and it's fun to stop in for the service we get at the sign of the Flying Red Horse.
Baby Birds. Now in the soundproof booth, Bruce Mansfield and Philip Brady are the brain teasers in Baby Boomers. Right, Phil, lead off.
Who became a journalist after graduating from Smallville High School.
Would that be Walter Cronkite?
No, it would be Clark Kent.
All right. What actor's son spent four TV seasons racing up and down the streets of San Francisco? What actor's son spent four TV seasons racing up and down the streets of San Francisco?
Mike Douglas.
Kirk Douglas.
The actor's son is Mike Douglas.
No, Kirk Douglas's son is Mike Douglas.
Yeah. You asked what actor's son?
Yeah, what actor's son?
Yeah, and
I want the actor.
Oh, I thought you wanted the son.
Well, don't fight about it.
Well, get your tapes rolling, folks. Tonight could be the night.
It's a big one coming up after seven.
What spread when such a long way?
A little X. No, a little PEX.
A PEX paste. That's
goes
the one.
A long way.
Yeah.
And here's one for you, Phil. Who played the other lover of the young man Glinda Jackson was in love with on Sunday, Bloody Sunday?
Peter Finch.
Yes.
Thank you.
Another winner. Congratulations.
What overdressed character used to wave regularly to Australian TV audiences from the top of an aeroplane gangway?
What well-known, what was it?
An overdressed character used to wave regularly to Australian TV audiences from the top of an aeroplane gangway.
No, I haven't got it.
Mavis Bramston.
Of course.
You're on Remember When with Bruce Mansfield and Philip Brady. Now, 3AW National Network News.
-15 degrees in Melbourne, windy with showers tomorrow and a top of 14. It's 7 o'clock. Good evening, I'm Ron Burke. In this news, a huge rescue operation off the South African coast. Transport to bear the brunt of Victorian government spending cuts, and in sport, a new Aussie world champion. A Greek cruise liner which was carrying more than 600 people is sinking off the coast of South Africa. A rescue operation including ships and helicopters is battling 20-foot waves to save the passengers and crew. More from the BBC's Fergal King.
The ship is being tossed about and is still taking in quite a lot of water. They say that as many as 500 people are now in lifeboats, and that's quite a considerable number of people for any kind of rescue operation to try to deal with. We should also bear in mind that many of those people are elderly and would not be in the best physical condition to try and deal with what must be a tremendous ordeal.
Back home, a hotel bottle shop attendant remains in a satisfactory condition in Dandenong Hospital after having a bullet removed from his leg. Police say the man was locking up the Central Hotel at Beaconsfield late last night when an armed bandit struck. The robber, armed with a .22 semi-automatic rifle, burst into the hotel, forcing the attendant to lay on the floor while he emptied a cash register. Police say that before leaving, the bandit fired two shots, one into a telephone and the other hitting the attendant's left thigh. Transport is set to be the big loser in the coming state budget, but spending levels in education and health will be much smaller. Finance Minister Tony Sheehan says the government is committed to pruning expenditure across the board by $600 million.
Health is the most protected service delivery area. We're looking for relatively small cuts from health. Transport, we're looking for a pretty substantial contribution. Education is part of it. We, as a large portfolio, it's an obvious area for savings. We haven't asked for anything like the level of savings from education as we've asked from some of the other portfolios.
The Bureau of Air Safety will examine two metal fragments that fell from the exhaust system of a Thai International 747 over Sydney yesterday. The pieces fell into a house and a car park as the plane took off for Bangkok. A bureau spokesperson says the incident isn't considered serious because the plane continued its flight and arrived safely at its destination. He says the Civil Aviation Authority will decide if a fine should be imposed on the airline once it receives the bureau's report after the examination tomorrow. The president of the Yugoslav Republic of Serbia has rejected any suggestion that the European community should deploy a peacekeeping force to the troubled region. He says the ceasefire plan by Yugoslavia's collective leadership is the best way to achieve peace in Croatia. More from the BBC's Jim Fish.
After meeting the leaders of the two breakaway republics of Croatia and Slovenia, the three European foreign ministers had a meeting with the president of Serbia, Mr. Slobodan Milosevic. In what can only be described as a pointed rebuff, the Serbian leader ruled out any deployment of an international military force to keep the peace in Yugoslavia. European community representatives, he said, were welcome to Yugoslavia as politicians, diplomats, businessmen, or tourists, but not as members of foreign military forces.
Turning to sports, and Australia's Rodney Martin has won his first world squash title by defeating Pakistan's Jahangir Khan in the final, 14-17, 15-9, 15-4, 15-13. Greg Norman goes into tonight's final round of the Buick Golf Open in the US, three strokes behind American Marco Dawson. Norman has fired a third round 71 to be 13 under the card for the tournament, while Dawson has shot a 64 to be 16 under. In AFL matches played today, the West Coast Eagles 14-11-95 have defeated Adelaide 11-14-80, putting paid to the Crows' finals chances, and Fitzroy has recorded its second win of the season, beating Richmond 23-19-156 to 13-19-95. And winners in the VFA today are Coburg, Williamstown, Werribee, Dandenong and Paran. News time is 7:15. Melbourne's weather mostly cloudy with a little rain developing, cool with a fresh gusty north to northwest wind. The outlook for Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday, all days windy with showers and tops of about 13. On the bays, north to northwest wind, increasing to 30 to 35 knots tonight, then to 30 to 40 knots tomorrow and tending west to northwesterly. Waves rising to 2 to 3 metres. The forecast temperature range down to 11 overnight and a top of 14 tomorrow. It's now 15 degrees in Melbourne. I'm Ron Burke, 1278 3AW. Back now to Remember When with Bruce and Philip.
Seriously though, ladies and gentlemen, in this segment of Blankety Blanks, you'll learn how Graham Kennedy is a member of a new religious group called the Jehovah Bystanders. They're something like the Witnesses, but they don't want to get involved. was called Fresh Up, and it was used for Life with Dexter as a theme with Willie Fennell and Ashley and Janie and all that crowd. Remember it? Wonderful 9 o'clock special tonight, Phil, that even I haven't mentioned to you, but I know very well that it'll bring back many memories.
Yes, and of course, after 10 o'clock, we have our radio drama, don't we, as always?
That's right.
Looking forward to it, old buddy.
In actual fact, I think we might cut the 9 o'clock special in half, and because it's a complete episode of Something You'll Love, and we'll have the first half at 9 and the other at 10.
Fair enough, and also coming up very shortly, the history of the Yarra River tonight.
Why?
In the Melbourne Story.
Oh.
That's why.
How long would that run? Oh, it's about 14 miles, isn't it? Okay, let's open the lines and go back to your memories of your first days at school or the fashions you remember or even the corner barber shop. Shirley's next online. Hello, Shirley.
Hi, Bruce. How are you?
Good. Hi,
Shirley.
Wonderful show. Lovely. Tuesday at school, where I went as a child and thinking about saluting the flag on Monday mornings. Also, the headmaster would come in every Monday and give the girls and boys question and answer time, you see. Anyway, not being a terribly brilliant scholar, I shot the hand up when it was the boys' turn to answer the question. And the headmaster said, "Yes, Tommy Hill," and I cringe, and I can still remember that, and that's 50 years ago.
And the school's still there where it always was in Peel Street.
No, and I'm looking at Coronella's page the other day. Snuggle Pot and Cuddle Pie. I used to go to the Kew Library to get all their books. I adored them. Gosh, it brought back memories of little skits.
You probably used to swim at the old Kew Baths just down the road.
And went to Eli's Corner where they had beautiful ice creams there.
Yes.
Also, the Rickabites, up on the top of the real estate agents there on the corner of Denmark and High Street Kew.
Right.
Yeah, and I'm afraid I broke that golden pledge. Anyway, not to worry. I was expanding my beautiful session that I listen to every night to my stepdaughter who phoned from Castlemaine. Her health hasn't been too well. And we've been talking about you two guys. And anyway, she was telling me, you know how everyone asks in about your health, how are you, blah, blah. She was rather ill at the time, and she was getting sick of people saying, well, how are you today, or blah, blah. So she went to a meeting, and she walked in, and this guy on the door said, and how are you? She said, I'm suicidal. So, oh, that's great.
It's true. Nobody listens, do they?
They don't. I'll have to ring the boys up about that.
Oh, that's wonderful.
That's marvellous.
She's kind down on two other people.
Oh, that's lovely.
I'm suicidal. Oh, that's great.
She must have a sense of humour.
Oh, yeah, she's cute.
Oh, well, you've made us laugh. Listen, would you like a box of chocolates from the chocolatier, Shirley?
You've already complimented me with some weeks ago.
Oh, have I?
Absolutely divine.
Yes.
Wonderful. In fact, my niece took me out then. She works in rather a large hotel in the city who has a number of tourists in there. So, Mark, we saw Mark. I grabbed a handful of cards from him, and she's going to spread the word in the city.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
That's terrific, Shirley.
Okay.
Thanks for the call, dear.
Yes, and thank you so much.
Good night. It's 10 past 7 on 3AW's Remember When. Hello, Merle.
Oh, hello. Bruce, first of all, the lady who was ringing up about Coronella, I can remember when I was born in 24, and when I was about 4, I think, there was a big family next door because they'd all sent away for Coronella to get the badge and the certificate and that, you know, and because I wanted to be in it too, but it was a penny stamp. And they said, we'll send away for you, you know, and I can remember they stuck an old stamp on with jam. Well, I just about had, you know, I was only young, but I knew it was wrong. And it worried me. I thought, oh, I'll come and put me in jail or something, you know, putting it on with jam. But I got my badge back and certificates and that, and I was quite happy when I brought memories back when the lady was talking. Well, that would have been back at about 28, 29. So it was going pretty well then, so it must have started. We used to have it on, anyone said about, it was the Ginger Meeks comic, and Coronella was on the inside pages of the Ginger Meeks comic.
Ah, yes.
Some years.
Yeah.
I think it might have been in the 50s when they dropped putting the Ginger Meek comics into the Sun every Saturday morning. And then Coronella was just a must as far as, the kiddies and that were concerned.
That's right.
And something else, you were talking before about the barbershop. I used to work for a barber behind that glass counter. You were asking what was in it. And I can remember one day the chap came in and he said he wanted something. It was San Francisco. Well, it took me a while to wake up. And I wake up, then he wanted Californian poppy.
Yes. Yeah. That was about the only hairdressing, along with straight eight, that you could get. Thanks for the call, Merle, and the memories. Hello, Helen.
Hello, boys. How are you?
Good. Hello, Helen. Fine, thanks.
I was just thinking back to my secondary school days with the peanut machine outside the tuck shop where you'd put the penny in and turn the handle and you get a handful of salted peanuts that were in a big glass bowl.
That's right.
And I remember one day it malfunctioned and I ended up with my school dress skirt filled with peanuts.
You hit the jackpot.
The tuck shop lady could see her profits going out the window, and I was very popular that day with the girls, of course. School papers, they used to be a penny each, and they came each month. And there was one for grades 3 and 4, and one for grades 5 and 6, and I think grades 7 and 8 as well. And there was a song on the back, which you were usually taught over the loudspeaker by a man in the choir from the ABC. And they had plays in them and stories, and we just looked forward to those just tremendously. And the other thing I remember about clothing is the hoop. Do you remember the hoop?
Yes.
And I had one and I was wearing it. I was going in to meet my boyfriend to go to a dance at the university. And I got on the tram in Burwood and had the hoop on. And as the tram filled up, I had to keep moving up the seat and squashing up next to people. And by the time I got into Batman Avenue, the hoop was completely squashed, sticking out the back and right out the front and right in at my sides, so that my dress was actually falling through it. And I had to sneak into the tram inspector's shed there at Batman Avenue and try and get this hoop back into a circular shape. It was just so embarrassing.
That's funny.
Dreadful, dreadful. So that's a fashion that I'm glad's gone.
Yes. Oh, that's lovely memories, Helen.
Mm.
Can I tempt you with a box of chocolates from the chocolatier?
Any day.
They are beautiful.
Any day. Thank you.
They're in Waterdale Road, Ivanhoe. Just hold the line and I'll get back to you, Helen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Good night.
Good night. And Evelyn is next. Hello, Evelyn.
Hello, Bruce and Philip.
Yes, Evelyn.
I'm one of your oldies. And I'm going back to a little country school that I went to. And I think it must have had the smallest attendance of any school in Victoria. We had 8 pupils, and I don't think any child ever failed an exam. We had a marvellous teachers all through.
Which school was it, Evelyn?
Name was Crichton.
Yes.
You know where it is?
You tell us.
Well, it's on the Hume Highway, or it was, it's gone now, 6 miles south of Euroa.
Uh-huh.
And it's in the days when with the sixth grade we used to sit for our qualifying certificate. In the eighth grade, we sat for our merit certificate, and I always prided myself on what a good speller I was. And I've never forgotten one error I made in my merit certificate in dictation. I've never forgotten it. I put 2 L's in frolicking.
Yes.
Which was, dreadful. I was so ashamed of that. And then, of course, the council used to give them certificate to allow us to go on to high school every year. And then at high school, of course, we had to go on board in Euroa. we got our intermediates and leaving certificates in those days. And I want to go back to the fashions then too. I was the first girl, I think, in the district to wear bobby socks at a tennis match.
Right.
And my mother was rather old-fashioned. She was about 44 when I was born, and she didn't approve of all these things. She was most embarrassed to think I was wearing these socks. And then when the sleeveless frocks came in, oh, my goodness me, well, arguments over that. She thought they were disgusting, absolutely disgusting, sleeveless frocks. And, of course, I'd want to wear them naturally like every other young girl. And when the two girls in the district came out in the first long frocks to a ball, all the other mothers thought, oh, the girls look as if they've got their night dresses on. Oh, there's a lot of memories I can go back to. We can spend hours.
Those sleeveless frocks then created a demand for Nair products, didn't they?
Absolutely. Oh, they were only hussies wore sleeveless frocks, according to my mother. I've got an old nature study book I've kept. We used to have nature study in the schools in those days too.
Yes.
And I've still got one of my nature study books. Back about 1924, I think.
Well, you hold on to that, Evelyn. That's a precious memory for you.
Oh, I'm very proud of that, yes.
Okay.
Oh, it's been lovely listening to all these old stories of schools.
And yes. Thank you for reminding us about your school days at Crichton.
It's 17 minutes past 7 on 3AW. Do you remember when pantyhose came in, Phil? They were very hard to get. That if one leg laddered, you'd chop the defective leg off and team up with another pair.
Graham used to give them away on the Darrod's wheel. 6 pairs of panics that fit where you sit.
That's right. Or the major prize was the Simca Aron.
That's right.
The
Simca that lifted its skirts.
We used to go to dancing classes, or I didn't, but they were very popular. The point of dance classes was that you could go to the dance class social night and nobody really ever wanted to actually dance. All the girls wore gloves and the boys wore suits. We were allowed to wear very pale pink lipstick and matching nail polish. I'm reading out of a book that a woman wrote, by the way.
Did you have to escort anybody making her debut?
Yes, once at the Collingwood Town Hall.
Oh, you did?
Yes. I'll never forget it.
Right.
It was about 12 at the time.
Right. So she came out.
Well, that's when all the girls came out.
Yeah.
And it's incredible that debutantes are on their way back. There's a lot of girls who like coming out.
Oh, yes, it's very fashionable. And I'm sure you've compared a few deb sets over the years,
too. Oh, yes. Only recently I compared the girls of Heidelberg who were coming out.
Oh, good for you.
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to come out with a commercial break, if that suits you, okay?
I'd like you to.
Unless you've made your will recently, changes to legislation, taxation, or your family situation could well mean that your will is now out of date. Ultimately, it could mean that assets may not be distributed as you wish. Updating your will with National Mutual Trustees is an easy, low-cost exercise. Talk to National Mutual Trustees about your will today and put your mind at rest.
Holiday trek in the wilderness turns into a nightmare for one terrified girl alone on the mountain with a psycho killer. Her only chance of survival, the two men in pursuit. Her fiancé and a cop.
You slow me down, the surrogate killer.
And they hate each other.
Let her go or die!
A terrifying adventure, a heart-stopping chase. Sydney Poitier, Tom Berenger, Kirstie Alley in one of the year's great action movies. Deadly Pursuit, tonight on 7.
Would you have any gurgling music out there?
Certainly. That's the best I can come up with.
We continue the Book of Melbourne, the story of a city, why it started, how it grew, what it's like today, by Carolyn Dowling and Noel McCracken, published by Oxford Australia. Tonight, the Yarra. Well, the Yarra didn't always follow the course we know today. At different times over millions of years, its direction has been changed by the shifting of the land, by lava flows, and by the water itself cutting into the rock and soil beneath and beside it. The lava plains to the west of the Yarra River are fairly flat, and the soil is poor. To the east, the land is hillier, and the soil better. The river was an easy place to get rid of rubbish in the early days of settlement. The open drains in the street flowed into it, and because a lot of the land near the river flooded easily, it was cheap. So factories were built along the banks close to the city and could dump their wastes in the water. The night soil men of the 1860s emptied their carts into the Yarra from the Johnson Street Bridge. When people objected, they did it less publicly, pouring the sewage down the banks from nearby market gardens. Even then, people protested against using the river as a rubbish dump. Today, you're more likely to catch a fish near the city than you were 20 years ago. One day, the Yarra might even be safe for swimming again.
Hello?
You're with Bruce Mansfield and Philip Brady.
Somebody knocking on the phone.
On 1278 3AW.
Did you ever hear of anybody marrying a man?
Sure. Who? My sister.
Don't let the stars get in your eyes. Don't let the moon break your heart. Stars get in your eyes. Oh, keep your heart for me, for someday I'll return, and you know you're the only one I'll ever love. Too many nights, too many stars, too many moons could change your mind. If I'm gone too long, don't forget where you belong. When the stars come out, remember are mine. Don't let the stars get in your eyes. Don't let the moon break your heart. Love blooms at night. In daylight it dies. Don't let the stars get in your eyes. Oh, keep your heart for me, for someday I'll return, and you know you're the only one I'll ever get in your eyes. Oh, keep your heart for me, for someday I'll return, and you know you're the only one I'll ever love. You're the only one I'll ever love.
On 3AW's Remember When, Giselle McKenzie.
For a thrill, drink your fill, and the lemonade man, Mr. X, comes around your way. Lemonade he brings as he gaily sings, lemonade, lemonade all day. Lemonade, lemonade, ask the lemonade man, for a few pence he will trade. The finest drink since the world began, Mr. X's lemonade.
Good evening to Bob Horsfall, heard there with the X Lemonade song. 24 and a half past seven on Remember When. Hello, Terry.
Yes, Bruce.
Yes.
I'd like to remind people about a place on the corner of Plenty Road and Bell Street. There used to be the Galville Hotel, Burrell Motors, Fisher's used to be the grocer shop on one corner, and Alchin's the draper shop on the other. And just up the road, about three doors, was hairdressers. Now, the hairdresser's name was Mr. Wolf, and he was quite an entertainer, because during the period of getting a haircut, he was always a little bit half-cut, and he'd go out the back and get his violin or his trumpet. and he'd come out, and he'd start playing either instrument while he was cutting your hair, and he'd give you a few notes on the trumpet or the violin, and away he'd go. I don't know how many of your listeners will remember Mr. Wolf, but he
must have been the first busker, Terry.
Oh, he was unbelievable. He really was.
You'd have to be careful that he didn't cut an ear off.
He was an incredible fellow. He really was. He was around for years. And Frank Rogers, up on the junction corner, I think his shop is still open. Now, he would be one of the original barbers in the Thornbury area. I don't know whether that area, whether you chaps know. But,
yeah, I don't know it that well, although my father had a business in Bell Street, Thornbury.
Right. Bell Street, Preston, it would have been.
Oh, right, yes.
Yeah. And another thing was we had an army depot on the corner of Ragland Street and High Street.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was a youngster, I used to live down the bottom end of Ragland Street in the Housing Commission houses. And on the weekends, they used to have army manoeuvres, and they used to have the tanks running down Ragland Street. And it was nothing to see a herd of sheep being herded down Ragland Street as well when I was a youngster.
Well, Phil has many, many an encounter with sheep in the Kew area when he was growing up.
In the 1940s, sheep being herded through the Kew Junction. Terry, can you believe it?
Yeah, it's unbelievable, isn't it? And you know, if you tell people today that people used to herd sheep up and down Ragland Street, they wouldn't believe.
Yes, that's right.
Anyway, that's all I have to say.
Thank you for the call, Terry.
Hope everybody remembers.
Lovely of you to ring.
Thank you.
Good night. Rex is next. Hello, Rex.
Good morning. Good morning, Bruce.
Good evening.
Morning. Good evening. Where are you? I'd just like to say that I've been listening to radio for 45 years, and I was sort of brought up in the country, and I've been in Melbourne for about 40. But and I would like to say that you two are the funniest gentlemen I've ever heard on the radio. And also, I'd like to relate back to my school days. I went to school in the country. I went to school in to eight different schools all over the countryside. But two of them that brings to memory, I went to school in a place called Arrowatta, which is 5 miles from Currumburra, and on those great big hills there, dairy country. And they used to deliver the milk in the... You remember those big 5-gallon cans?
You used to see them, although I'm not from the country, you used to see them a lot on the side of the road when you take a spin into the bush.
That's correct, yes. They use them now, I think, for letterboxes, don't they, half the time? But anyway, they used to deliver the milk, and because it was pretty cold down there in that area, and the teacher would ask us around about 10 to 10 to go out. We had an open fireplace there, two of the boys to go out and bring the milk can in. And of course, on top of the milk can would be this thick cream.
Oh, lovely.
And how many boys' fingers went into that before he actually got it inside?
Yeah.
Anyway, then he'd put it on the fireplace, and we'd go with our Dixie mugs and have it with our cocoa.
I remember when I went out for spins in the country with my mother and father, we'd always come back with a bottle or a container of clotted cream.
That's correct, yes. Well, anyway, then we went on then to, we went to school at, it's no longer there, it was next door to a cemetery. It was called the Shepparton Park State School. Anyway, only 13 children went there, and from grade 1 to grade 8. And we had a teacher there, one of the teachers, well, he's passed on now, but his name is Mr. Killane. And he used to say to us that on Friday would be a handy day. You know, they used to have a homework day or something, it's called, and you had to bring in tools, and the girls would do knitting, and the boys would make crystal sets. And he'd say, righto, Rex and Barry, it's your turn to bring in the soldering iron. So anyway, and the what's it called, the flux stuff, is it? Anyway, we'd say, all right then. So if we didn't bring it in, he'd make another boy, the biggest kid in the third out of the 13 kids, to go outside and watch to see if the soldering iron was coming to school. And every time we didn't watch, he'd make the kid bolt us across the head. So one day we never brought it in, and the teacher made this big kid come out and stand over me. And I said, "Oh, you won't give me a clip, will you?" He said, "Yeah, the teacher told me." So we finished up having the greatest fight of all time.
who won, Rex?
And, oh, it was a draw, I think. But I had a black eye, and I think he had one too. So we went back inside, and he made us both stand out there all afternoon and watch to see if the soldering iron was coming to school.
Oh, that's lovely.
And just another quick thing that I'd like to mention, that my friend, they came out here from England, and they stayed in the hostel out in Brooklyn, and it was right next to Borthwick's Meatworks.
Yes.
So you could imagine in the summertime, people coming from England, getting into one of those huts and getting the stench from Borthwick.
Oh, and about 105 degrees in the shade.
And 115,000 different flies.
Oh, yeah. So that was in one of those migrant hostels, Rex?
Beg your pardon?
That would have been in the Brooklyn migrant hostel.
Correct, yes. And the people coming from a beautiful place in Wales, coming out to there on their off-pit plan. And she often tells me about it now, that they say, "Come to sunny Australia and make a new life."
Oh, that'd be frightful.
You know, it would be unbelievable.
You wouldn't know what struck you.
Well, she might have come out for £10, but she didn't have the best accommodation when she got here.
Thanks for the call, Rex. Lovely of you to bring us memories of the little schoolhouse in the bush. 28 minutes to 8, 3 AWs. Remember when? In a moment, our radio historian.
The Great Aussie Run begins on August 6th. To pledge your support for the runners and help Cystic Fibrosis Association throughout Australia, call the 3AW Great Aussie Run hotline on 827 7698. Supported by the Metropolitan Fire Brigade and 1278 3AW. Caring for the community.
Introducing Louise Nicholson, nutritionist, and Dan Presser of Sunraysia Natural Beverages.
Dan, tell me about Sunraysia's oolong tea in cans.
Sunraysia's oolong tea is a new tea drink for consumers who seek a truly natural diet.
What kind of tea is it?
There are basically three kinds of tea, Louise. Black, which is fully fermented, green, unfermented, and oolong, which is semi-fermented.
Tell me about the sugar content of Sunraysia's oolong tea.
Sunraysia's oolong tea has no sugar content at all. Ideal for people who can't have or don't want sugar in their daily diet. And it's virtually caffeine free.
Sunraysia's oolong tea is 100% natural, with no artificial flavours, colours or kilojoules. Drink it hot in winter or iced in summer.
Sunraysia's oolong tea in the convenient black and gold ready-to-drink can is available now at Safeway and Coles supermarkets near you, and also at the Myer Melbourne Food Hall.
Hello there. Have you ever been approached to be the executor of a will? Then take a moment or two to listen to this.
I was really honoured when Barry asked if I would mind being the executor of his will. I mean, we'd always been mates. Then a couple of years back, my wife and I went to make our wills at State Trustees. Talking to the people there, I found out all the things an executor has to do. I soon realised that being an executor was way over my head. Then they said I could be a joint executor with State Trustees, and I should talk to Barry about it. So I did.
The duties of an executor can be demanding and complex, requiring an understanding of law, taxation and accounting. By appointing State Trustees as executor or joint executor of your will, you can relieve the burden of this task from family and friends. So before you appoint an executor to your will, telephone State Trustees today on 667-6444. State Trustees, the experts in personal financial administration.
On 3AW, you're with Bruce Mansfield and Philip Brady on Remember When.
From the studios of Radio Melbourne, come the beautiful sounds you know so well.
3AW Melbourne.
says 3KZ Melbourne, calling in the Brockhoff Network, 7HT70X, 3MA, 3HA, 3TR, 3SR, 3UL, 3YB, 3SH, 3NE, 3BA, and 3GL for junior information. And now over to the compere of junior information, John Ford.
And here's the compere for our local radio nostalgia tonight, Alex Hare. Good evening, Alex.
Good evening, Bruce and Phil.
Good evening, Alex.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Welcome
and
back.
Thank you very much, Phil. It's lovely to be back. And it's Alex Hare with you once again for another nostalgic walk back through radio of yesteryear. Jim Berenson there opening our session tonight, calling in the Brockhoff Network for 3KZ's Junior Information with John Ford from the 1950s. Of course, John, well known later on 3UZ for his newsbeat. Well, back to 3AW now. In July 1966, and this own studio block for 3AW's Coal Van Show with Bruce Mackay, heard every Saturday night, and as part of that particular show, Bruce featured 30 minutes of 78s in a segment he entitled Golden Weddings. Of course, the theme he used was the famous Woody Herman recording of same. At the time this program was going to air, there was only one other program in Melbourne playing nostalgia, and that was at 3GL Geelong. Let's go to the tape and memories of Bruce Mackay.
That was my guy, Mary Wells. 3AW time is just after 8:30 on the Colvan Show. There it is. That's the opening of our first recording from Fred Astaire in the program now. Brought to you by Coal Van Chips, the Golden Wedding segment.
What is a chip? A Coal Van chip is as light as a puff, as crisp and fresh as the morning. A king-size family pack of Coal Van chips is full of ideas. How popular they are for snacks, how delightful they are to serve with meals as a happy surprise. Open a family pack of Coal Van chips, pop them into the oven for a moment, and as simply as that, you have an extra time-saving idea to serve with a family roast, or with grills, or fish. Cooked in pure vegetable oil, Coal Van chips are starch-reduced and low in calories. And when you finish the last one, you'll be looking forward to opening the next pack. Coal Van chips are everybody's favorite.
The Coal Van Show. The Golden Wedding segment of the Coal Van Show, through until 9 o'clock. Yes, good evening once again, and welcome to you and those people that enjoy this program every Saturday night. And for the people celebrating their golden wedding, our very, very best wishes go out to you and everyone having a silver wedding anniversary or any type of wedding anniversary on this particular Saturday evening. We send our very, very best wishes to you.
A fine romance with no kisses. A fine romance, my friend. This is, we should be like a couple of hot tomatoes. A fine romance with no clinches, a fine romance with no tension. You never give the orchid eyes and the glands. No, you like cactus plants. This is a fine romance. Oh boy, what a romance.
A Fine Romance, presented by Fred Astaire. 3AW time is 25 minutes to 9. At 9 o'clock we have more Macquarie news from the Macquarie newsroom. It's the Burke Appliances. I was going to say the Burke Appliances, but they're on, of course, for the Midnight to Dawn show between 12 and 5 morning, and I hope that you'll be listening in for that one. It's the Coal Van Show now through until 12, and then Burke Appliances, but stay with us for lots and lots of wonderful music. We play for you now this particular oldie from Russ Morgan and his orchestra,
You remember it, I'm quite sure, called Does Your Heart Beat For Me?
Music in the Morgan manner, fading away, the Colvan Show, and memories of Bruce Mackay. He didn't seem to know where he was there for a minute, but recovered nicely. And the last I heard of Bruce, he was in Perth, involved in radio over there. One integral part of radio over the years have been the many competitions made available to the public by sponsors and stations. Here now are promotions for competitions run on 3AW in 1967. The first features Jeff Mannion. But can you identify the second?
Hello, 3AW, radio auction.
I'd like to bid for radio auctions, please.
I have 114 points and I'd like to bid for radio auctions.
Is that radio auction?
Hello, this is Jeff Mannion. On Monday, October the 3rd, 3AW's radio auctions commence on my afternoon program. Now, radio auctions is an exciting new radio game in which you can win wonderful prizes. And it's very simple to play radio auctions. All you have to do is this. Firstly, shop at your local SSW food store. The radio auction product will be prominently displayed in the store. Secondly, pick up your radio auctions booklet at the checkout point at your favorite SSW food store. This will explain how the competition works, and it's quite simple. And finally, make sure you listen to my afternoon show between 2:30 and 5 each afternoon. $10,000 worth of fabulous prizes, including television sets, washing machines, refrigerators, and stereograms to win.
Coming to 3AW soon, Wettex Dial for Dollars. Wettex Dial for Dollars is a fascinating radio game that anyone can play. All you need is a surname and a Wettex pack. So stock up now with wonderful Wettex and keep the guarantee handy, because we'll be asking you questions about it when you phone the station. Wettex Dial for Dollars is coming soon to 3AW.
This is 3AW, and it's Remember When with Bruce, Philip, and Alex.
And that was Dennis Gibbons' voice, wasn't it, Alex?
It was indeed, Phil. I wonder how many out there in listening land got that. Dennis Gibbons with the promo for Wettex Dial for Dollars on 3AW. Memories now of 3DB and their silver fox, John Eden, and longtime newsreader Jeff McComas. On Sunday, June 5th, 1967, war broke out between Israel and Egypt. On a cold Monday morning, we woke up in Melbourne to the first news of the war that had started some 12 hours earlier. Let's join John Eden now and the lead up to the 7:45 a.m. news, one of the major bulletins of the day, Monday, June 6th, 1967.
The daily thought for the day: the reason mountain climbers always rope themselves together is to keep the sensible ones from going home. Train... well, you've got to try. Interstate and country trains all run next time this morning. Mildura will be in at 7 minutes past 8 at Spencer Street. The Overland from Adelaide at 25 to 9. The Aurora at 9. Spirit of Progress at 5 to 10. And the Aubrey at 20 minutes to 12. Lighting up time for motors tonight. Mate, 8 minutes past 5.
Now, put yourself behind the wheel of the new Toyota Crown Custom 6, the most luxurious car under $3,000. Surprise yourself at the fabulous extras that don't cost extra. Toyota Crown Custom 6 has a power of performance, too. Test drive Toyota Crown Custom 6 at AMI, 559 Elizabeth Street, Melbourne, or your local Toyota dealer.
3DB and 3LK, key stations in Victoria of the major broadcasting network, 7:45. Let's have some fun. Let's sing along 4:20.
Oh, what a lovely pie, me boys. Oh, what a lovely pie. 4:20, make the best. Oh, what a lovely pie. Oh, what a Cornish pasty, boys. A lovely one to try. 4:20, make the best. Pasties and meat pie. Lovely pies and Cornish pasties. 4:20, make the best.
Chuck, 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 a mint pie, dark chocolate, it's creamy.
Real mint taste, it's so creamy.
It's coated with chocolate pie.
Peter's chocolate pie, delicious Peter's mint ice cream wrapped up in luscious dark chocolate.
Oh, that's for just 10 cents.
Peter's chocolate pie,
the health food of a nation.
This is the Herald Sun Radio News, read by Jeff McComas. The threat of escalation mounts as the war between Israel and the Arab countries continues. After more than 12 hours of fighting, correspondents in the area say there is no quick victory in sight for either side. About 250,000 metal workers have decided to seek a four-hour national stoppage following yesterday's national wage decision. Melbourne police are questioning 6 men and 3 women in connection with armed holdups in the Melbourne area. And 25-year-old Richard Speck has been sentenced to death for murdering 8 nurses in their Chicago hospital in July last year. And the weather in Melbourne should be cool and fine with light winds and the top temperature near 60 degrees. The war, which broke out between Israel and the Arab countries yesterday, has flared up during the night and the threat of escalation mounts hourly. However, after more than 12 hours of fighting, correspondents in the area say there is no quick victory in sight for either side. The key is believed to be in the bloody tank battles along the Sinai Desert border and the air battles raging over the area. After a night of claims and counterclaims, it appears that Israel is advancing in most sectors after stopping an Egyptian attempt to move against Israel with tanks and planes. The Israelis have also struck military airfields in Egypt and the Suez Canal region. However, Egypt has said it's holding its own and claims a number of Israeli tanks have been destroyed.
Well, Phil, I think on that news, we all expect, I was working at GTV at the time, and I the word around was that that was going to be the big one. That was going to be the Third World War.
Oh, yes. When was that, Alex? The 6th of June, in the year again?
1967.
Right. And that turned out to be what, the Six-Day War?
That's the one.
Yeah.
Alex Hare, who has a great collection of local radio memorabilia, which is rather nice.
And we'll go back to it, Alex, after we take a break on 3AW's Remember When in 1991.
How will you invest your lump sum when you retire? There's the good old bank.
Next, please.
And won't the tax man be happy? Invest in a business. But some of those are... Or talk to your National Mutual agent about investing in a retirement income annuity and get a regular guaranteed income for a fixed term or for the rest of your life. It's like having a job without having to work.
Yep.
National Mutual Retirement Income Annuities. Peace of mind. For the most important person in the world, you.
Hi, this is Pete Smith inviting you to join me Wednesday, August the 7th at the Celebrity Concert in aid of the Bone Marrow Donor Registry of Victoria Support Group. Special artists include Karen Knowles and the Seekers, the Maroondah Singers and the Footscray Yarraville City Band. For tickets at $25 each, phone the Bone Marrow Donor Registry on 342-7888. 342-7888. That's Wednesday the 7th of August at 8 p.m. St. Michael's Uniting Church, 120 Collins Street, Melbourne.
You're with Bruce Mansfield and Philip Brady.
Keep big muscle, you know.
On 1278 3AW.
And joined by Radio's Alex Hare.
Thanks, Bruce. Back to it. Now, here's a selection of commercials, all presented by 3AW personalities of the mid-1960s. How many can you remember?
There must be 1,000 different types of musical instruments at Allen's. So no matter which one you want, if you strum it, stroke it, thump it, pump it, beat it, belt it, bong it, dong it, spin it, chin it, or blow it to the high seas, Allen's have it. Allen's World of Music, 276 Collins Street.
Fletcher Jones says, men of all shapes and sizes feel comfortable in Fletcher Jones' expertly fitted trousers.
Fletcher Jones says,
Ralph Rickman and David McGee.
Fletcher Jones trousers from $11.95. That's under £6.
All the fragrances in the world are assembled at Ball & Welsh. Fragrances like
Ralph Rickman,
Bond Street, Lavender from Yardley. This Christmas, choose her favorite fragrance from the international collection of gift wrap perfumes, cosmetics, and toiletries at Ball & Welsh, Flinders Street, Frankston, Camberwell.
Graham Evans and
Ralph Rickman. Football with Schweppes on 3AW.
Don't be satisfied with anything but the best football broadcasts. Listen to 3AW next Saturday for Norman Banks and Doug Haywood describing the Carlton-South Melbourne match. And stay tuned at 5.30 for Football Roundup, in which every game played is covered by 3AW.
Follow the football with Son 3AW and keep up the schwepsmanship.
Great memories of AW personalities of the mid-60s there. To 3UZ now, and back in November 1964, the following DJs were working at UZ. Jim Wood, Ken Sparks, Don Lunn, Don Rainsford, Alan Lappin, Dick Hemming, John Vertigan, and Jeff Warden. Some great names there, some sadly no longer with us. From that same era, here is a potpourri of station jingles, including the opening to the 3UZ Sports Scoreboard Show.
You get all the news and all the sports, all the traffic and weather reports on Dial 930. Fun radio, it's great. The latest reports from the world of sports on the 3UZ Sports Scoreboard.
It's first and actual.
Fast and actual. The greater 3UZ Sports Scoreboard. You're at the games and events.
The races and
the tournaments and matches. Inside seats.
And the thrill of the game and the spirit of the crowd.
And I would give you complete and comprehensive news on the greater 3UZ Sports Scoreboard.
Some great memories there.
Alex, with respect, can I play this?
24 hours of wonderful radio, all day, all year long. Radio Melbourne, 3AW, the talk of the town.
Lovely, Bruce. Lovely to hear it without the crackle from off-air. Never mind. Let's move along now and to the Len Wynn Tour Show. Now, Len Wynn Tour spent a relatively short time at 3AW, and one of his duties was to do Saturday nights when Bruce finally left the station. He presented a radio magazine-type program with music and taped interviews. In this air check, we hear the theme music for District Cricket Notes with a mention of Jacobs, of course, still with 3AW. Following this, Len had intended to play a record. However, as we shall hear, all did not go according to Hoyle.
This is 3AW. The time is 6:45. Cricket Notes presented by Dobson's Dependable Men's and Boys Wear of Glenferrie and Forest Hills Drive-In Shopping Centre. Listening next Friday night at 7:10 for District Cricket Notes with 3AW cricket expert Bill Jacobs, brought to you by Dobson's Dependable Men and Boys Wear of Glenferrie and Forest Hills Drive-In Shopping Centre. Turntable trouble here tonight, so I think we might just transfer that to another one and see if we can get a little bit better vocal out of Jerry Wallace than what we got that time. He sounds as if he was really running downhill, so just bear with me one moment. Let's see what we can do for you this time.
I don't care if the skies are cloudy.
long as you're with me. It's a fine and dandy cotton candy world.
These days, the music played on air is in the main either on CD or cartridge, so there's no scope for playing wrong speeds or failing to lock in the turntable at the right speed notch. I'll bet he was glad when that disc finally finished. Well, we're all familiar with pipe music. We enter a bank or a lift or whatever, and we get pipe music all the time. The most famous brand of same is probably Muzak. During the 1960s, there was some connection between 3AW and Muzak, and I was always intrigued by the huge reel-to-reel recorders which stood in the 3AW foyer, churning out hour after hour of canned music. This promotion we're going to play now is for Muzak, and it's by Dennis Gibbons.
Suitable as background music. But Muzak, the scientifically designed background music, can help efficiency and production in any business. Various businesses require background music for a variety of reasons. In some places, it may be the noise which is distracting, while at other establishments, silence can cause boredom. And Muzak overcomes both these problems. World-famous musicians and arrangers record on the finest equipment to meet the demanding qualities of the musical directors of Muzak. And it is this music which can improve efficiency in your business, whether it be a factory, bank, hotel, restaurant, or store.
Dennis Gibbons and a promotion there for Muzak. And I'll never forget those huge tape recorders. They must have weighed a ton each in the foyer here at 3AW. Well, a listening must for me in the early 60s was the Stanley White program, heard every Sunday morning at 11:30 through till noon on Sunday. And I recall with much pleasure the bright theme and catchy slogan which introduced the program.
Hooray, we shall all have money put away for a rainy day. That's what I say to myself, says I, jolly good luck, hooray. There's been lots of trouble for a long time now, but every dog must have his day, bow, wow, wow.
There we are with the Stanley White program theme played by Jack Hilton and his orchestra. And of course the theme music, There's a Good Time Coming, is probably apt for the times we currently live in. Stanley White, the little man with the big reputation. You may recall his jewelry store was in Little Collins Street on the corner of Howie Place.
Coming for the bookies, I'm glad to say. That's what I say to myself, says I, a couple of bob each way. There's a good time coming for the bakers, you ought to know. That's what I say to myself, says I, they jolly well need the dough. Happy days are here again, so shout bow wow. Come and have a tizzly at the old brown cow. There's a good time coming, be it ever so far away. That's what I say to myself, says I, jolly good luck, hooray.
There's a good time coming, the Stanley White program theme from Radio 3XY. Well, now, earlier on, I was listening to this show and a gentleman mentioned the Faker McGangies, and just a couple of things on that. Bert Newton was in it, also my very good friend John Finlayson, Louis Fiander, Bruce Mansfield even had a little role in it there for a time. It was hosted by the late Gene Lawson, however, none of it was ever recorded. But I can give you a little sample of the theme, which I've happened to bring in with me. It's from the Bosworth Orchestra. It's called Up With The Curtain, written by Jack Strachey.
I think you'd like to join me in thanking Alex Hare for a very interesting spot in Remember When tonight.
Alex, obviously a lot of preparation went into that and it was well worthwhile, and we'd like you to come back and do it another time on Remember When.
Thank you, guys. It'll be my pleasure.
AW, you're on Remember When with Bruce Mansfield and Philip Brady. Now, 3AW National Network News.
It's 15 degrees in Melbourne at 8 o'clock. Good evening, I'm Ron Burke. In this news, nurses planning industrial action and a huge rescue operation continues off the South African coast. More than 1,000 nurses will stop work tomorrow afternoon to protest against state government plans to employ untrained personal care attendants in nursing homes. Nurses will stop work at the Williamstown, Frankston, St. Vincent's and Austin hospitals, the Mount Eliza Geriatric Centre and the Bundoora Extended Care Hospital. Federation Secretary Belinda Morrison says stop work meetings will be held every day until members at all Victorian hospitals have voted on the action. Ms. Morrison says nurses are horrified at the thought of unregistered staff performing nursing duties.
And through that registration, they become legally accountable for their nursing standard of care. The people that we're talking about in this new category will be untrained, will be unregistered, and we don't believe it's in the public interest to have unqualified people providing nursing care.
A rescue operation is underway off the east coast of South Africa after a Greek cruise liner with more than 600 people on board started sinking in heavy seas. The vessel is drifting in gale force winds about 4 kilometres offshore. The BBC's Fergal Keane takes up the story.
The Oceanus got into difficulties late last night. It sent out a mayday call saying that one of its watertight compartments had been holed and was taking in water. A spokesman for the South African Navy said the ship was being battered by huge waves with winds of up to 50 miles an hour in the area. According to the Marine Rescue Centre here in Cape Town, a number of people jumped into the sea when the ship began to sink. As many as 500 others are in lifeboats. Many of them are thought to be elderly passengers drawn from a mixture of nationalities. The South African Air Force and Navy have dispatched helicopters and 4 high-speed boats to the scene. A large medical team has been sent and a number of cargo ships were due to help with the rescue.
A man has had a bullet removed from his leg after being shot during an armed robbery last night at a hotel in Beaconsfield. Police say an armed bandit walked into the bottle shop of the Central Hotel on the Princes Highway and demanded money from the attendant before firing 2 shots. The victim underwent surgery at Dandenong Hospital this morning and is now reported to be in a satisfactory condition. Hotel licensee Bruce Pollard says the attendant was forced to lay on the ground before he was shot.
He was the life I stand. And then, as the bandit was escaping, he shot the telephone and then shot Michael on the leg. And then Michael was told if he tried to chase him, that he would be fixing up good and proper.
The state government says new figures show the cost of owning an average family car in Victoria is now almost $200 cheaper than in New South Wales. Treasurer Tom Roper says people north of the Murray have higher taxes, fees and fines, which all add to the cost of running a car.
Well, they're saving on registration, they're saving on special weight charges that they have to pay in New South Wales, and they're saving on third-party insurance, so that for many families, the saving can be up to $200 a year.
American President George Bush will seek a second term in office following talks with his advisers. White House reporter Jim Stewart.
In a meeting with his top political advisers at Camp David this afternoon, President Bush made it all but official that he is off and running for a second term. The meeting lasted 3 hours, during which the president gave his approval for Republicans to begin organizing and fundraising this fall for his re-election bid. White House spokesman Marlon Fitzwater said only general campaign issues were discussed this afternoon, and more specific themes will be decided on at a meeting later in the fall.
To football now, and Fitzroy has won its second game of the season, upsetting Richmond by 59 points at the MCG. After a low-scoring first quarter, the Roys pulled away from the Tigers to pile on 8 goals in the second quarter.
Final scores, 23-19, 156 to 13-19, 97. And West Coast has put Adelaide out of finals contention with a gutsy 15-point win at Football Park in Adelaide. Final scores, 14-11, 95 to the West Coast, to the Crows, 11-14, 80. Australia's Rodney Martin has won the World Squash Championships in Adelaide. The Queenslander has defeated Pakistani champion Jahangir Khan in four games, 14-17, 15-9, 15-4, 15-13. News time is 8:04. Melbourne's weather, mostly cloudy with a little rain developing tomorrow, cool with a fresh gusty north to northwest wind. The outlook for Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday, windy with showers and tops of about 13. On the bays, north to northeast winds increasing to 30 to 35 knots tonight, then to 30 to 40 knots tomorrow, tending west to northwesterly, waves rising to 2 to 3 metres, and the forecast temperature range down to 11 overnight, up to 14 tomorrow. It's now 15 degrees in Melbourne. I'm Ron Burke, 1278 3AW. Back now to Remember When with Bruce and Philip.
Hello, Dave.
Hi, Graham.
I've missed you terribly.
Well, you'll have to throw straighter. Listen, I've got to tell you.
Baby boomers for you to play at home with Phil and myself. And now, Phil, you're going for a packet of Persil in the snatch and grab quiz.
I'm ready, Mr. Deese.
All right. Who finally married Helen Crump?
Oh, you see, I'm not into these American.
But no, it may not, be.
Helen Crump.
Oh, you wouldn't know. It's very hard. Andy Taylor. Here's a better one. What Australian trouser manufacturer was knighted in 1974?
Fletcher Jones.
Sir Fletcher Jones.
Now, this one might trick you. What colour boots did Superman wear? What were the colour of his boots? No prompting from the audience?
Well, his main uniform was blue. The S, I think, was red. I'll go for red gumboots.
You're quite right. His boots were red, old boy.
Thank you so much. What airline promised, you're in good hands all the way?
When you fly TAA.
Ansett ANA.
Oh, yeah. Incorrect. I should have thought more about that.
Sorry.
I don't think I'm ready for Sail of the Century yet. What comedy segment was the best love feature of the Kashmir Bouquet show, Calling the Stars?
Macaque Mansion.
That's right.
What 1969 Australian film with Rowena Wallace was adapted for a TV series?
A 1969 film with Rowena Wallace became a TV series? I Can Jump Puddles.
You Can't See Round Corners.
Oh. You can play along with us. Bruce and I deliberately get some of these wrong to make you feel better at home about it. Who played the title role in TV's... Oh, I say that when I'm not doing so well. Who played the title role in TV's Western Cheyenne?
Clint Eastwood.
No, no, the wrong Clint. Clint Walker. Couple more, buddy?
Yeah.
Why not?
Who was called the wronged woman in the Elizabeth Taylor Eddie Fisher affair?
Debbie Reynolds.
You're right.
And finally, what writer guest starred as the judge in the final episode of the original television series of Perry Mason?
What writer?
Yeah, guest starred as the judge in the very final episode of the initial series of Perry Mason.
What judge?
In fact, it was the author of the Perry Mason books.
Oh, his name, oh, let's escape me. Not Hillary Queen.
Three names?
Earl Gordon Chandler. Earl Gardner.
No, he was an evangelist.
No, Earl Gardner Chandler.
No, Earl Stanley Gardner. Can't play that.
Oh, that was pretty good.
Oh, it was close, but not close enough.
It was all right, buddy.
Not close enough to send you off with Compass Airlines, I'm afraid. Better luck next time.
This is 3AW's Remember When, 8:09.
Your clothesline may look like the place to freshen and dry your clothes.
But watch out for breezes that blow pollens, wattles and dust right onto your sheets and pillowcases. Arm & Hammer dryer sheets may help beat wheezes and sneezes. With Arm & Hammer dryer sheets in your clothes dryer, you'll help keep those sneezes away. With Arm & Hammer dryer sheets, your clothes will smell like a summer breeze without the sneeze. Available from Safeway, Coles and selected Tucker Bag supermarkets.
I'm Neil Mitchell. Last week we had the only radio interview with the sacked head of WorkCare. We let you ask John Hewson direct about the consumption tax, and we were first to talk to the 92-year-old father. This week, the first anniversary of Joan Kerner's rule. What has she achieved and where has she failed? We'll have an inside look at Marilyn Monroe's relationship with the Kennedys, the Melbourne kids who were champion cooks, plus a special report on the airline price war. Is it all just a big con?
Your town, your voice. Talking Melbourne with Neil Mitchell. Weekdays 8:30 till noon on 1278 3AW. On 3AW, you're with Bruce Mansfield and Philip Brady on Remember When.
And do you appreciate it? Do you?
Soon, the tales of the unexpected on Strange But True.
Now, how old would you think bikinis are? Think closely about this. I've already asked you about Superman's boots. Now I want to talk about bikinis.
Good question. I remember that they were banned. Anyone with a bikini was hurled off the beach at Elwood in the 50s, even for just showing an inch of bare midriff.
Yes, well, you know, I would have thought they went back to the time of the testing of the atom bomb on Bikini Atoll.
Yes.
I would have thought in the 1940s, hey, that's when bikinis came into vogue.
Yeah.
But we'd both be wrong, because the ancient Romans were the first people in the world to design the bikini. In fact, a leather bikini made by the Romans and dating back to the first century AD was discovered in a well in London.
Goodness me.
Obviously some Roman nymph just flung it off and threw it in the well.
But being a leather one, she would have been quite an outspoken, outlandish individual, wouldn't she?
Or she probably wore boots and had a whip as well, wouldn't you imagine?
She would have been Rome's answer to Madame Lachaus.
Oh, very much so,
or
yes.
Or Hal Lachaus.
Yes, I think she was married to the Marquis de Sade.
I don't know whether they were into that in ancient Rome, but they were a very decadent race.
Well, you've heard of those orgies, surely.
Orgy.
She probably discarded her bikini at an orgy, wouldn't
yeah.
you imagine?
Well, I don't know. I've never been to any of those, and I don't intend to. Not like you, Phil. You've been around quite a lot.
Oh, well, I've been to a couple of Channel 9 Christmas parties.
It's 12 past 8. What about a break and then themes like old times, darn it?
Let's go for it, buddy. In themes like old times tonight, we're going back to one of the best-loved radio serials of all. Remember Hagen Circus, the show of shows?
Wonderful.
Starring Guy Dolman.
Yes.
The serial used several themes, including Saluting Base and also Grand Parade. And this was the linking theme through each episode, Private Officer Prune. was called Private Officer Prune and was played by the New Century Orchestra, conducted by Sidney Torch on the FDH Mood label from Hagen Circus.
Would that have originally been a theme to a British show called P.O. Prune?
No,
that's such an unusual title.
It is an unusual title. No, I think that's just, they had a lot of zany titles in those days, like A Portrait of a Flirt and Jumping Bean and The Runaway Rocking Horse.
But P.O. Prune, that's one...
Well, there you are. It was nice to hear it again, wasn't it?
Oh, lovely.
The Max Afford serial, Hagen Circus, always one of my favourites.
Who was in that?
Well, Guy Dolman was in it for one, Marshall Crosby another.
Yes.
And... Neva Carglin.
Mm. And Gordon Glenwright, I think, had the occasional walk-on. But then in radio, you'd never know.
Ella May Morse.
Oh, she fuzzed it.
She was.
You go mad. You just let your mind run wild.
I'm just dropping a few names.
We've got a wonderful 9 o'clock special tonight you'll love. And you may not know the title of it, but everyone listened in.
It's still in the Gladstone bag, is it?
Still in that black bag. Look,
and you're going to break it up in two halves, between 9 and 9.30, and then the second half at 10. Is that what you have in mind?
Yes, it's a complete episode. So for those of you who are devotees of radio, just... turn the lights down a little and sit in the subdued twilight of that room and enjoy radio.
You won't mind me sitting here munching on a nut and reading a paperback.
No, but I want you to follow it so we can discuss.
Well, I will. You can ask questions later if you want to, Goebbels.
Yeah, I generally do, but you're always wrong.
It's like being in Dachau.
Why spend long, tiring hours in the laundry when you could do everything in the family wash quickly and easily with a Hoover electric washing machine? No wonder more than 150,000 Australian women have already bought Hoover electric washing machine. And no wonder those 150,000 Australian women are the Hoover's best advertisement. They know that the Hoover will do the entire wash for a big family in minutes instead of hours. 4 minutes for whites, 1 minute for woolies. And the Hoover's exclusive pulsator floats out every speck of dirt so gently and thoroughly. Put a Hoover electric washing machine into your laundry for next wash day. £53.5 cash or a small deposit and a few shillings a week, make it yours.
For smoothest ever mowing of fine, fine lawns, for fastest ever cutting of sky-high grass, use the V-I-C-T-A. Victor! Victor! Motor mower.
Step into easy street with the mower that shaves fine lawns smooth right to walls and edges.
Turn grass into lawn with a Victor.
18 past 8 on 3AW, and Phil, there's no star in Melbourne's past or present that we get queries about.